This is a sailor. His home, the ship. The greatest movable object men can build. The 26-foot motor whaleboat is made of 20th century plastic. But it too must honor the way of the sea, the tradition of the sea, that were known and honored since 20 centuries ago. The sea can wear out and destroy any material known to man, just as so many times it has worn out nations and empires who didn't understand it. Whatever you do upon the sea's domain, you honor the sea. Or else, there is nothing trivial at sea. There is no such thing as a little leak, a little bad handling, a little failure. The sea makes mincemeat of the very idea. You might say that the only little thing at sea is the imagination of the man who forgets, even for a moment, that the sea is special. It is. You and the ship in which you serve must measure up to it. The poet will not understand the phrase, it takes a heap of doin' to make a worthy ship. You are afloat and moving, a force upon the waters of a continually troubled earth, thanks to the grace of God and the laws of physics. The sea has commanded the very image of the ship. The hull is of a certain shape, and all within it must keep the ship within the shape the sea commands. Shape is more than meets the eye. It is the form of what a man does to be worthy of the ship that is worthy of the sea. Since the dawn of time, seafaring men have known that a ship demands the strictest awareness of the harsh, relentless, powerful domain of the sea, where the very waves of water had their birth half a world away, where even if the world were completely at peace, you would still keep a constant watch upon this changing and various domain, the sea. Without a single human enemy under the sun and the moon, the sea is adversary enough. There is nothing trivial at sea. Here, where the great waters are nearest of all, you can't see them, but they are there, only inches away. And every valve, every movement of hand and wrist and eye is the movement of mind as well, honoring the presence, the might, the special nature of the sea's domain. Go up now, up the ship's ladder, up the scale of years and rank. In a world at peace, in a ship of pleasure, he who commands from the captain's bridge would still command as a matter of right and of logic. His word is a form of law, for the sea is no ordinary place. It is a worldwide realm of its own, making its own rules. Unquestioned command and unquestioned responsibility in any ship at sea are a fact in human relationships because the sea is a powerful autocrat. In a ship of war, where danger from other men on other ships or from men in aircraft or on the land itself is a constant consideration, you only compound, you only multiply the meaning of command. To be worthy of the sea is challenge enough for any man, for any ship. But to be worthy of combat at sea is challenge indeed. Were he a civilian receiving 100 times his pay, he could hardly be more important in responsibility for the lives of men, for the fighting ship, for the purposes of a nation, that has much to do in a world with such a long way to go before it is at peace with itself. In an age when massive annihilation is a matter of saying a few words and pressing a few buttons. As he is trusted by the nation he serves, so must he trust those who serve the same nation under his command. The sea moves. The ship moves within it.
Reveille, reveille, all hands heave out and trice up. Smoke lamp is lighting all berthing spaces. Now reveille.
Time moves. No wave, no ship, no moment is quite like any other moment that came before, that will come later. Nor is any sailing man. Routine, you say, because it seems you've done this work before. It wasn't designed with fascination in mind. It was, in fact, commanded by the fact of the sea and its nature, by the fact of the world and the kind of people who live in it. All work is special work here. This realm of salt water is 70% of the Earth, or 40 times the size of the United States. All the oceans run together, creating this single sea of the planet Earth. Beneath these waves live more forms of animal life than upon dry land, at varying depths from the surface to thousands of feet down. From oil to gold, from iron to magnesium, minerals of the dry land are duplicated as a source for future food, for future resources, for future prosperity. This sea over which you sail now is Earth's newest recognized frontier, old as it is. A whole science, oceanography, takes in the sea from the viewpoint of the biologist and the mineralogist, the geographer and the geologist, the engineer and the physicist, the chemist and the doctor of medicine. In truth, this watery realm that meets the eye from horizon to horizon is already the working place of millions of people. You are not alone. But so vast is the sea that you are among the first of the practical oceanographers. You are ahead of the rest of the world that will be following, that must be following, for the exploding population and the declining resources of the land are making men look more and more to sea. To know the sea is to have power at sea. Sonar training, for example, takes in the character of the sea, the differences between warm and cold water, the sounds of objects within the sea. These audio fingerprints of everything from a shark to a submarine, from a turtle to a whale, are indeed new forms of observing, therefore of learning. To steer a ship is to take proper respect for wind and wave and weather. To navigate is to be attuned not only to where you think you're going, but to where the sea will let you go. In a submarine, there are depth limits, but on the surface too, you must be aware of the deeps and the shallows, the currents beneath and the winds above. To read the radar is to scan the domain of the sea in terms of its churning surface and of the air above, reaching 100 miles to the environs of nearby space. The air above the sea is part of the sea's domain. This, too, is the naval tradition. From here, too, the sounds of the sea on sonar and the electronic visibility of radar comprise the ongoing practical oceanography of a Navy that keeps creating new ways to see this planet of ours in terms of the sea's eye and what it holds, be it a fish you can eat, oil you can pump, or an enemy you are hunting down, even perhaps as he hunts you. Oceanography in war or peace or in between is part of the very meaning of sea power today. The great nations who race to the moon race here too. So you're on the move. The Navy life is the moving life to range the wide world. It is time to rise. Yawn if you must, but do not sneer. The poet has words for the likes of you. Clay lies still, but blood's a rover. Youth is a ware that will not keep. Up, lad, when the journey's over, there'll be time enough for sleep. Perhaps coffee is more to the point. Do not underestimate yourself. It takes a real man to drink coffee like this. A little bit of it goes a good way. A little bit of it reflects the way of the sea upon this ship, which is worthy of the sea because men have made it that way. The bridge is the special neighborhood of this seagoing community of a single purpose: to keep America strong upon the sea, therefore upon the earth. Men are closer than they say, more perhaps than they admit. Trust, the silent compliment, goes along with the responsibility. It is taken for granted that you will do your duty. Below, men who trust you to do your duty are trusted in turn by you. The sky down here is bright with tungsten light. Here, where the great fighting ship responds to command from above, in a jungle of lines and valves and gauges, the man is the measure of the ship. It's dark out, but somewhere else upon this single sea of earth, the sun shines down upon the Navy ships and the men who serve in them. The sea, for all its planet-wide immensity, gives way in good time to the land. The land, the small part of the planet making up a few hundred nations, is today, as ever in human history, divided. As there are nations, there are conflicts, crises, wars. Americans have known battle throughout the earth, on four continents. Toward a distant shore, it can be any shore, anywhere, the ship moves. Other ships move with it. Each ship is a piece of sovereign America, answerable only to the will and wisdom of the American people. Each Navy ship is the pointed spear of American purposes, insofar as these are defined in military terms by the American people through their chosen leadership. Thus, the Navy Marine team, thus the most complicated of man's military endeavors, the amphibious operation. Somewhere ahead, where the great single sea gives way temporarily to the land, is a shore on which the naval power of the United States is now brought to bear. The amphibs move in. Escorting warships protect the landing. and search for enemy ships upon the surface or below it, or enemy aircraft above. Suppose then, for national survival depends largely on how well we do suppose things, that enemy aircraft were on the way to break up this amphibious operation. Radar picks up the attacker. His speed and bearing of approach go into the computer that is programmed for just such a supposition. Up go our aircraft. Up from the largest permanent floating moving airfield on this planet. A mobile air base that can be nuclear powered. Radar and the computer tell them just where to go. Computerized controls aim the very missiles themselves. It has been thought about beforehand, which is to say that it has been supposed in detail by men. Those who talk to the machines we call computers, those who know how to use them for what they are, servants, however ingenious, but still servants to the flesh and blood that comprise a navy. No less than they do a nation. We will always need the men to make the decisions in this age, when just pushing a button is climax to long years of education and preparation. While enemy planes are attacked and destroyed, not just here, but elsewhere too, as necessary, the amphibious operation proceeds. It could be any of 100 shores. It could be anywhere, for that is where American sea power goes. The human skills and talents add up to a summation of the American experience in every field from nutrition to nucleonics. The teamwork. Within the water, in the air, over the land. Everywhere in this particular part of the sea's domain is no mere exercise. It demands the individual in fighting trim. The individual who has done a lot of studying to know what he has to do now. In such a way, America moved from island to island across the Pacific. The Allies invaded Europe and defeated the Nazis. This operation is entirely different, and yet, for all that, somehow, the same. Just as this ship is a relative of all the ships that men have sailed across the sea, it belongs to the future, and the future ships men will man. For her propellers are driven by nuclear power. The atom is going to sea. The ships of the Navy take many forms, but each is shaped to the way of the sea and the naval mission within the sea's domain. There are fighting ships. There are ships that carry fighting men. There are the ships that replenish the weapons, the material and the food, the medicines, and the thousands of items that fighting men and fighting ships need. But all the ships go into harm's way to serve the purposes the American people assert. Sea power is power in the sea's domain. It is power that is based upon the shores of the land as well as upon the waters of the sea. Sea power is the hard logistics of keeping in touch, keeping armed, keeping supplied. Sea power is organization and administration. Sea power is command and control. Sea power is vigil. It is a watch upon the skies above as well as upon the shores and waters below. Sea power is the comradeship of men who come from the 50 states and from Puerto Rico, from the District of Columbia, from foreign countries too. Sea power is men above all else. It is ships and weapons, machinery and methods. But with man, more than ever, the true measure. Upon this sea, your ship bends sails into the time to come, to meet the test. Your children's children will find it, no doubt, as picturesque as you see these ships that have gone before. Navy thoughts are long thoughts, for the future depends on the past that gives it strength. This very moment is already history. You are making it. Power at sea, replenished from the sea. Power that moves where the need is, where the ships are, where the action is. Where it might be tomorrow, or the next day, or a month from now. And yet, with even greater power, when such scenes as this are erased with nuclear propulsion. Power sustained, dependent only upon America herself. The flag flies by the right of the sea upon this mobile military base that is free from the whims of foreign politics. A bit of homeland for all its special seagoing character. A sovereign fortress, this fighting ship, to protect the 70,000 miles of sea lanes by which the free world trades and lives. These maritime nations that must cross the oceans thousands of times every week. The fighting ship is the summation of the best of America's technology. Every part of the ship reflects the science, the engineering, the seamanship, and the mission in which Navy men work and live. If the power of the atom's nucleus is the best we have to date, then that is what the naval mission demands. It is the power that causes the sun to shine and burn and give warmth and light to the earth and the planets. It is the technology of the future, here today, here now. You live with it, learn from it, and never forget it. The nuclear submarine can stay below for as long as men can stand it. It is the first true submersible. All conventional submarines being but surface ships, finding temporary duty under the water, having to rise frequently to recharge batteries, to get fuel. In all man's technology, in all his science, there is little to compare with the complexity of the nuclear submarine. 425 feet long, it is home to 140 men for 60 days at a stretch. Its space is packed with such items as a nuclear reactor, turbines, weapons, sonar, communication systems, inertial navigation systems, about 40 computers, and some 30,000 spare parts. But first and last, it carries this special cargo, the ballistic missile named after the truest and most constant of the stars, that by which every mariner finds true north. The Polaris missile, 16 of them. For them, the submarine exists to serve as a mobile launching platform that can bring them within range of any target on the planet Earth. Polaris, tempted as we are to call it the ultimate weapon, or even the ultimate deterrent, it too, as in all the work of man, but a glittering transition on the way to something even more effective. And so, 140 men live, work, and relax within this product of some 11,000 industrial companies, retained by 200 million Americans. Ready for instant retaliation, if God forbid it ever becomes necessary. You come in good time to respect the real significance of your work at sea, where every man, where every skill are linked to one another to make the fighting ship what it must be. There is a brotherhood here that goes beyond rank and circumstance. The sea is the ongoing unity of all who serve. The ship, whatever the seeming routines and arduous demands, is the special home that keeps danger away from home itself, that puts out the flame of trouble before it burns too hot or too near. The big nuclear-powered ship, even the biggest, is small within the greater sea that rounds the world. Within it, the special neighborhood of Navy men, resolving into tight little groups of special purpose, within that greater single purpose the Navy serves. There is always, it seems, something to do, but always, too, something new to learn, to keep you moving onward in life, even as the mission moves onward, upon this sea, within it, and above it. This great domain that man must master, the sea, as old as time on Earth, is as new as the years that are yet to come, as new as the intelligence of the young, who live and learn and work in this special place.